Members, it's time we start the second session of the meeting. We will end at 1 p.m. and again we will give the floor to the deputations and individuals to speak first. May I remind you that you have each up to 3 minutes to speak. Your written and verbal submissions are not protected by the electrical powers and privileges ordinance. And please take note of the various security measures contained in the guidelines for members of the public attending meetings at the attending meetings of the council and also those in public gallery. The guidelines are already attached to the invitation letter sent to you by the secretariat, and you may also approach our staff for a copy. If you have prepared a written speaking note, you may hand it to our staff before you leave. After deputations have spoken, I'll give the floor to the administration for a short response before I invite members to ask questions. We have another session at 5:45, so for members who can't speak in this session, your turn will be deferred to the afternoon session. All right, the deputations are coming in. I'll give the floor to them first. Now we will start. Ms. Lee Yin Fong. May I begin now? Yes, please. I was rather reluctant to come, but I was forced to come, except by Mr. Lee Kim Wah. I'm one of the affected villages living in Kutong. We've never asked for compensation or rehousing. The secretary talked about no diminution and no clearance claims by us. I think we are forced to this position by you. Our request is very simple. We just want a life. Why do you force us to buy flats or to live in PRH? Do I have the right to choose to live in a village house? We're not in your way, in the way of your development, but there can be various ways to develop a site. And the government claims that there is no land, this and that. But if I remember correctly, in 2013 or 14, we came to say this. You claimed that there was no land. We suggested to you that the Fanning Golf Course could be resumed for housing development. And then after half a year or so, you sold a site to San Hong Kei at $2.8 billion. It's now under development, and it looks pretty. I think you're worse than bandits or robbers. Burglars would only take away your money when they burgle into your home, but the government is taking away our homes, which took us many years to set up. And what should villages do now? I don't know how to put it, but I am very sad. In 2013-14, I came to speak a few times, 3 minutes each. What did you expect me to say? We have a land hoarded by developers there, and you have not tackled them. If you were subject to the same treatment, and if you were in our shoes, how would you feel? It's not that we are reluctant to leave, but this is a free society. We have our own choice. Have you ever asked us? We're only given 3 minutes. Do you find that sufficient? Mr. An Fei Ming. Thank you. Many villagers are trying to tell you that all they want is their homes. Are the officials here present willing to communicate with the deputations and individuals? Communication is important, but it must not be top-down, but bottom-up, so that you can really get the real message from the villagers. Like this public hearing, you come with preconceived ideas. Are you willing to amend your plans? This is most important. If you have no intention to amend your plan, it's pointless for villagers to express their views. So can I invite the secretary to tell us whether this is the case? Well, we have our own meeting procedures. It's now your turn to speak. And there are rumors and hearsay in society. I'd like to know where these rumors have come from. I urge the secretary to visit our villages to genuinely understand our needs and our requests so that you can really be people-oriented. Don't be a government that collude with the developers. Just like Mr. Li Kinhua said, the interests of villagers are being sacrificed and you're using villagers as your capital. And Mr. Lau Kok Fan, I thank you and welcome your visits to our villages to hear from us what we want. But you've only met with some of the villagers. You have to understand their background more. Now, if you say here that the majority of the villagers have accepted the proposals, let me say it's not the case. Now, we have the rule committee, we have a rural committee there, and we have a so-called referendum. Now, it's not that we want to say a no to demolition and rehousing. We are forced to take this step. So I hope Mr. Lau Kok Fan as well as officials here be sympathetic of the feelings of members. Thank you. Ms. Chau Kut Yin, good morning. I live in Kutong as well. I think what we are going to say may be superfluous. Still, many Kaifengs living in villages affected are here this morning. So we feel that we have the obligation and duty to express to you our views. We can start the counter, the timer again. Okay, I will go on. In 2012, when I learned of the Northwest NT development plan, I was still a student. There was the third round of public engagement for Northwest NT. Myself, were one among the last to learn of that, just like members of the public. On the 20th of September, we went to a public consultation forum, and I took part in rallies organized by different villages. Before I joined the forum, I was naive enough to think that since 5,000 people would be involved, and then the forum was a place to encourage rational communication. But when I arrived, the situation was really boiling, and there were groups representing different positions, flying their banners and flags, and there were a lot of chanting, shouting, and quarreling at the forum. Being a young person, I thought that all stakeholders living in Hong Kong, whether they are within or without this council, should be a community free of political values and affiliations and convictions, and we should really realize the vision of building a bright future for Hong Kong, for everyone to share. This morning, we talked about the compensation policy for squatters, and I think in discussing all public issues, we should have this consensus first. And then I found that this vision was not included in the blueprint for our future. They had no regard for social justice. They only consider speculation and profits in land development. We wanted friendliness and sense of belonging and so on and so forth. I think we are on a different footing. So I think we have to face the real world. Thank you. Mr. Wang Yuming. No demolition and no rehousing. Mr. Wang Yuming, it's your turn. Good morning.
The government say that there is no land for public housing, but in fact the government has a lot of vacant land. They can also invoke the land resumption ordinance to resume land hoarded by the developers. They can also resume, take back the golf course and then put up public housing to meet all the needs of those in the waiting list. But the government doesn't do that. With regard to land hoarded by the developers, the government does not resume land. Instead, the government designed the so-called public-private partnership to enable the developers to earn more. And if there is any land development, the government should resume land and then auction land for development, rather than letting the developer to hoard up land and then do their own development without public considering any public interest. At present, because of rapid development, Yuen Long is always congested. The government claims to be people-oriented, but they resume land and drive away the villagers, but not resume the land and of the golf course, which is now being enjoyed by the rich and powerful. I believe that everybody is born equal, but in terms of land resumption, Hong Kong people are divided into different classes. The government seems to set up a different classes of people, and we are non-indigenous villagers, we are the outcasts, we can be abused. I don't want to continue criticizing the government, but I hear the comment of a new immigrant who was educated in the mainland. The person said that the Hong Kong SAR government was even worse than the pre-liberation Kuomintang government. Next, Mr. Yip. After reunification, the chief executives becoming worse and worse. Carrie Lam was said to be a good fighter. People thought that after she took office, she would do more in terms of land use planning, providing more public housing, adjusting housing policies so that the housing needs of the people could be met. But being a good fighter, she was only a fighter for the interests, in the interests of the developer. The developer cannot get land, and therefore she resumed land from the village, from the helpless villages, and then give them give land to the developers. Now, in the name of public interest, the government resume land and then give the land to developers for private development. And that is really collusion between officials and business people. At present, the developers are leading the SALG and the officials in the nose. Now, you are paid by public funds. You are not paid by the developers. Maybe after you retire, you get jobs from developers. Now, the developers lead, and therefore, housing property prices continue to rise. The developers are so rich that they even not able to bend down and pull up their socks. Everything goes into the pockets of the developers. We really can't bear with that. We are living in squatters. And you force us away and you drive away from our home. You claim to listen to us, but you just don't, you just disregard our views. You just follow the directions of the developers. The government claims that there is no land, you not conduct a consultation on land supply, but the developers have hoarded up land in the new territories. If they just give one third of the land held up by them, they will be able to meet all your housing, public housing targets. Next, Mr. Mac. Thank you, Chairman. I am an occupant of a shop on the staircase of Tokwa 1. Now they have started resumption for more than a year and a half. I have seen the many shops and dwelling and housing and dwellings have been compensated, but the shops in the staircase and also the rooftop structures have not been compensated. I want to ask the lands department on the following questions. Now, what is the basis for calculating compensation? And how much is the compensation? Would there be a timetable? Will you send people to the households in Tokwa 1 to discuss the matter? I hope the officials will come. Thank you. Thank you, next. Mr. Ho. Thank you, Chairman. Everybody knows the crucial issue is housing, and when it comes to getting land, and then everybody has interest. There's collusion of government official and business people. When it comes to personal interest, other people are in the wrong. The government has a lot of shortcomings. How much brownfield sites, how much green belts are there? How many hectares of brownfield sites, how many green belts sites? And what about reclamation in Lantau Island? It seems that there is no long-term plan. In the policy, in response to the policy address, the Liberal Party proposed to the government that there should be a 10-year plan. And then there is a review every 5 years. We definitely need public housing. There is a long queue. Now many here say that you drive me away, but many people are living in partitioned flats. Have you considered them? You just consider your own interests. I want to come to see Mr. Chu Hoi-tek, but he's not present today. He claims that land matters is his concern. He's elected by 800,000 voter. I live in Yuen Long. Why he opposed building a footbridge in Yuen Long? Now if you say the location is not right, you build it somewhere here, then build this one first, and then we ask to build, we can ask to build another one here. He called people shameless, but has he ignored his 80,000 voters? Next, Mr. Pao. I'm affected by redevelopment Tokawan. I live in a rooftop structure. I don't know where I can be housed. Will dwellers on rooftop structure be given compensation? I have been living in the structure for 9 years. There is water leakage, and also I don't know whether the lands department will come to talk to the residents of the rooftop structure. Thank you. Would you like to continue? Mr. Bao, have you finished? Well, that's all. I just want to know whether we will be rehoused. When we will be rehoused, and what's the difference? Whether those who live in rooftop structures will be given equal compensation as those living in the proper units? Whether we will be given public housing units, and whether the lands department officials will come to Tokawan to talk to the those living in rooftop structures. Thank you. Next, Ms. Poon. Just now, the Liberal Party claims that they are concerned about the grassroots, but I think Mr. Ho is not helpful. But that's okay. Now, we're talking about the new development areas, and then suddenly there are two from the redevelopment. Apart from new development area in areas affected by redevelopment, there are many problems. The residents are not clear about compensation. There is no information. People are waiting, and therefore they come here. They want to put their questions directly to the lands department. In the redeveloped areas, there are many groups who are concerned about land compensation and resumption. How the ex-gratia payments are affected, how the ex-gratia payments are calculated, and then there are also refugees or who are waiting for assessment as refugees, and they really don't know what to do. And there are also tenants driven away by the owners, and the tenants do not receive any compensation. And the URA said that nothing can be done. So I just want to know whether the lands department has anything to say on that. Now, after the URA has started resumption, there is no information given to the residents. The lands department, now you have heard that there are so many rumors, and people are worried. You should come to meet the residents and explain to them what is the arrangement, what has happened. people should be informed as far as the compensation and also rehousing is concerned. We are present because we want to talk to the Lands Department. Can there be a briefing not only in Tokawan but also in other districts to resolve these riddles? Thank you. Next, Mr. Li Yukeng. Good morning, I'm Li Yukeng. I live in Wing Yun Chun for 53 years. Four generations have been living there nearly 70 years. 2 years ago, the government started to resume land together with the three villages. We were the residents are very disturbed, and some elderly people suffered more seriously and they passed away. I thank the government for bringing this upon the three villages. The government put us on the edge. Now, after we leave Wang Chau, we have nothing. We have start from the scratch. And we may even have to bear a big loan. And we have to thank the government for that. The government is to demolish our house, destroy our community. We have many friends and relatives living in the village. The aunts and uncles, the cousins, nephews and nieces, we all live in the same village. We have strong ties to the land and we really don't want to leave. Suddenly everything is destroyed. Thanks to the government. The government says it is going to give us $1.2 million. It's a big sum, isn't it? But it's worse than before. The squatter licenses allow only 400 square feet. How can your structure be as big as 1,000 square feet? I want to rectify this point. We've made application and our squatter huts were approved. We paid rents to the government. The government should respect our right. The government should not smear us and say that we are illegal occupiers. Next, Mr. Law Hin Kei. Thank you, Chairman. I'm the Hong Shui Kiu New Development Area Concern Group. I'd like to thank the officials for meeting us and NACHCO members for meeting us. The government is going to build a new town, a world-class city, and there will be 170,000 people moving in, creating 150,000 jobs. It is the backup area for Qianhai. There should be a unique compensation package. The $1.2 million of compensation, extra compensation, cannot solve the problems of the villages. The new ex-gratia payment is not unconditional. The compensation is far less than the amount needed to buy a new home. We have a strong demand that is a unit for unit. If you spend $1.2 million on just construction, that will be able to house the residents. There are about 1,600 households which will be displaced. The government has the ability to deal with that, to facilitate clearance. We ask the government to build the SS flats as early as possible so that we can move in as early as possible. And also in the first 5 years, land should be waived. Rent should be waived so that people can be encouraged to take up the SSF units. 60% of the development area owned by the people. And also a group of people have rent land and built their homes. They spend a lot of money and build their own homes. Now, they are willing to sell the land to the government, and they just keep 1,000 feet for relocation. The government is going to resume their land, but they base it on old law made decades ago. It's different from the land resumption in urban areas, so the adjustment should be made according to market conditions and also according to land auctions. The small amount of compensation proposed by the government can only be good enough to buy a toilet or a partitioned unit. The government should respect private property and give a reasonable compensation package to the villagers. Kerry Lam in 2012. Oh, your time is up, Mr. Law. Next, Ms. Tong. The government ignore the demand of the people. They don't want to be demolished. Their homes to be demolished. They don't want to be relocated.
So why do I say that? Because the landlords actually would be given the incentive to increase rents sharply or to try to drive out their tenants. Even with the experience of urban redevelopment, you can see the same scenario, and the government is not actually offering protection for tenants, neither is it monitoring the situation. I wonder where the government is really trying to save money through the landlords. I've got several questions. Firstly, zero protection for tenants. Because of that, there will be a large number of squatter residents who have been forced out before the registration period, and they were not protected at all. So what kind of protection and monitoring policy would the government offer? And for squatter huts, residents who have registered, they would still face the risk of having their rents being sharply risen, and they may not be able to afford it till when they are rehoused. So would these residents be given full compensation? And would the government actually recognize what they're entitled to? For residents who are actually forced to leave, what kind of compensation or protection, monitoring, would the government offer? My third question is, after the registration period for a particular group of residents, there could be actually still the risk of existing tenants being sharply charged with sharp rental heights. So what would the government do to protect them? And for subdivided flats, several households living in the house, one household member could be a landlord, and then what about the other households in the same house? Would they be entitled to rehousing as well, like the landlord is? And also in the government's timetable, I'd like to know when would tenants be rehoused? That is, would their case be treated the same way at the same time as the landlords or not? Or would it, that is, would they be treated the same as in the case of residents affected in To Kwa Wan? The government says that it would adopt a policy of people-oriented, but it seems like landlords are against tenants. They're in different camps. And squatter residents are not given much protection, and residents have asked to be rehoused and also be actually given the same kind of protection. Next one. Good morning. I'm speaking on behalf of Kun Han, village residents. I brought a few papers with me. There's so much I want to say, but I don't think I need to repeat them. You would not change your stance anyway. First of all, let me say sorry to Wang Chau village residents because the fight throughout the years I have not supported it. Until now, when the government is going to take back our land, now I feel the pain. So I'm not going to say a lot today. I just want to say that the government has done nothing. And the latest compensation plan offered by the government is intended to cheat us. Don't believe them. We need to know that we should offer a compensation proposal to the government rather than the government offering their version of proposal. Why should they decide what they want to give us, like as if we are begging them? And also, from what the government said, green belts, well, they can change the land use as they like. Unlike what the secretary said, the squatters are illegal, temporary structures. But why did the government approve us building the huts there? You let us do that, and now that you want to take them back, what kind of government is it? So your acts and your words do not tally. Now in Kunhan village, have you consulted us, villagers there? Even though there are only three households there in the village, but you are treated us as orphans, you shouldn't treat us so unfairly. You want to have development, to build public rental units for more people, I agree. If you are building public rental housing for the grassroots, I can voluntarily move out. But now, you are developing the area for low-rises, for luxury flats. So you are actually offering us compensation as a way to conceal your bad deed. Officials, you are seated here today, and I think you are humane. You have humanity. But now that so many villagers are crying and so worried, why can't you be sympathetic to them? Thank you. Next one is Mr. Ng Xiaohang. I heard from members and residents about their misunderstandings about squatter huts. Not you heard it from government official and also even members of the democratic camp. Some people may think that NGOs like us or social activists like us always hold the villages for hostage and insisting on non-demolition, non-relocation. But squatter huts have a long history in Hong Kong, and the indigenous residents are being scattered in various villages. They have used to their own lifestyle and they have their own culture, and it's something that villagers are used to. When they're old, as what happened, the society have deprived them of the right to live. Non-demolition, non-relocation cannot actually be used as the ground for due compensation. And I think we use that slogan because we truly hope that the village networks can be retained. And we hope that our next generation can share the same kind of lifestyle, way of life. And I hope that every person will have the right, continue to have the right to decide what land uses should be made in where. If there's no democratic planning, then you should not force any villagers to move out. If there's any forced evictions, and that's the reason why we have chanted the slogan non-relocation and non-demolition. I'd like to say to the villagers in Chen Chau Chuang village, the core issue of the great debate on land supply is we want to, you know, have a bottom-up approach in deciding what to develop and where. Because we've now had injustice in land distribution, and because of the injustice, we're forced to change our way of life, and also our homelands will be torn down. So because of that, the four Chinese characters meaning non-demolition and non-relocation has become such a serious and heavy slogan with so much meaning. And so, and because of that, that insistence, my girlfriend and other people were sent to jail for speaking up against the plan to develop new territories northeast. And some people have lost their youth. Therefore, we want to change the slogan again here: non-demolition and non-relocation. Next one, Mr. Lau. I'm a villager in Kutong. I was born there and grew up there. Because of the development in New Territories Northeast, our life has been hardest hit. I feel that the government never consulted us. Therefore, sometimes I was at a loss. But I do feel that you should come to our villages more and to communicate with us, so that we know, like elderly people among us, they really don't know what's going on. And the government kept saying that there's no land, but is it true? We do have doubts. As you said, we need to take back our land for development. But that means that I really wonder your policy, whether you should have policy that has the minimum or minimal impact on people. You know, just for a small task. There are so many brownfield sites. Why can't you develop them instead of taking back our land, our small plots of land? Isn't that better? That's all I have to say. Thank you. Thank you. Next one is Ms. Chow. Here, I'm not going to say anything more to the officials, but I want to, you know, to people living in Kutong and all the residents living in squatter huts in Hong Kong and all the people who are suffering from high rents and also people who are left homeless in remote corners of Hong Kong, people without their own homes, I want to say that I've lived in Kutong for 4 years. I really miss the place. My understanding of the history of Kutong is not like what was portrayed by the government, not just limited to monuments and relics. Some relics there are not even recognized by the government. Kutong, it's a place where there were large landowners. But in the area, there were very brave villagers who had come all the way there to develop their community. Kutong village used to actually have such bountiful harvests and crops, but with development, the place is at risk. And then the place became also a shelter for all kinds of industries that could not survive in the urban areas. And now today, with the widening wealth gap in Hong Kong and land, unfair land in distribution, so Kutong has been a shelter haven for people marginalized elsewhere. And this is the place which has withstood all sorts of social injustice. people living there have tried hard to survive. And the arrangement for demolishing the squatters is a total disregard for the creativity and hard labor paid by the residents. And actually, there are people living there who would not be able to afford rents elsewhere, and yet they are forced to move out. If you're saying that the demolition is to resolve the land shortage issue in Hong Kong, I think that's ridiculous. Because everyone living in the squatter huts and also actually could not find any other where to live. And that's why they're staying there. You can see that, you know, we should be more creative in handling or sorting out the issue. Next one, Mr. Ho. Good morning. Just then, someone claimed that those who hope to remain on the land and do not have the homes demolished are actually acting against the interests of the grassroots. But I want to ask the government here, what has the government done for the grassroots? Who has deprived the underprivileged and the grassroots of their right to live? And it seems like you have relaxed the conditions for the rehousing, but I don't see anything in the paper which would let residents in squatter huts maintain their own way of life. This is something against the United Nations Convention on Sustainability. For you don't really meet the requirement or expectation for an international metropolis. The Wang Chau project is one that actually targets the poor, the underprivileged, for the sake of the better off. When the government kept saying that the hundreds of residents better sacrifice themselves, then how about the people living elsewhere? What sort of policies have you got? If you are saying that you want to build units for 4,000 people, and now here you are saying that the grassroots people, actually their interests are being compromised by the demand of the residents in squatter huts. But why don't you target the houses, small houses in the new territories instead? Is it that people who own the houses have more powerful rights or more power? Why don't you use golf course? Use the site of golf course. If you say that you're so concerned about the underprivileged, then how about urban redevelopment? And also the government's policy on other illegal structures, for example, rooftop structures and subdivided flats in industrial buildings. So why can't the government do, or hasn't the government done anything to amend the law? And why do you now actually force people to go the other way? Why can't the Development Bureau make adjustments or changes to the law? The government now saying that you're going to demolish the land, the buildings. I don't know who really here is acting against the interests of the underprivileged. We should not only talk about the development made by developers. We need to pay attention to the dignity of the grassroots and also their right to live. The squatter house will be built for 400 units, but we are talking about comprehensive planning, holistic planning. If the government is paying, time's up. You can submit your submission to us. Next one is Mr. Mack. Chairman, members, on behalf of the concern group for Hong Shui Kiu New Development Area, I'm speaking right here on behalf of the villages. The government has not made registration for farmers who are mostly tenants who are farming on rented lands, even though the landlords will continue to rent the land to them, but they will ask for higher rents. If the farmers cannot pay the rents, the landlords would seize the opportunity to take back the land. And that means that even before the government goes ahead with development, the farmers will be deprived of any sort of compensation. I hope that the government can carry out registration for the farmers. And your ex-gratia compensation and housing arrangement, as you proposed, made no mention of protection for farmers.
when you announced the development plan, after you announced it, the farmers have been subject to nuisance by suspected landowners. They are so exhausted now. Because of the constant nuisance, they had no choice but to give up farming. So I think you really need to register for them so that the rights can be protected. I ask that you should announce details of your compensation plan as soon as possible so as to encourage farmers to resume farming. Right now, the government's plan for agricultural development actually you tend to help landlords and farmers reach an agreement. I hope that you can do more because you can offer more options for the farmers, including giving them the right to keep bees and to grow fruit trees so that there can be more alternatives given to them. And they can also be given the chance to build their own homes. If you say that your compensation for fruit trees or other plants, so-called compensation, I would say that you should give a checklist of all the possible compensations offered to farmlands for farmers for their reference. Now, I'm going to talk about dogs. Dogs are part of our families. I now urge the government to allow dogs to be rehoused in resettlement estates. In 2003, there's a government subgroup that decided on the ban on getting tenants bring dogs to the households. But then there are exceptions made. So sometimes, for safety purpose, many households in the new territories would keep large dogs. But now your compensation plan has no arrangement for accommodating dogs. So can the government consider that you should not let us destroy our animals?
Mr. Ken Kim, Mr. Ken, please switch on the microphone for Mr. Ken. There is no need for you to press any button. Oh, I'm afraid I have Mr. Hoi Fat. I'm from the Alliance for Development of Hong Shui Kiu. Although we're not talking about Hong Shui Kiu today, we face similar fate, and that is our homes will be destroyed. I'd like to say this to the Development Bureau. The government has rehashed its position on squatters a number of times, saying that they do not have the right, legal right to live. They are just tolerated, and when necessary, when the site is required for development, then they will resume all private land occupied by squatters. That is why we cannot address the so-called top priority of the administration, and that is housing problem. Squatters in Hong Kong, it is a political issue because since the handover, the government is incapable of or determined to address illegal structures or illegal erection of squatters. Now, if you fail to do that, is it a political or legal issue? The government has relaxed the means test requirements. It is a political decision. We live in village houses. It is the way of life we choose. It was even before the promulgation and commencement of the basic law. All right, the basic law was promulgated for the handover. The people's way of life can be preserved. We do have the right to continue to live here. In Chapter 3 of the Basic Law, there are various articles on how to implement the Basic Law. Article 31, Hong Kong people have the right to move houses, and Article 33, Hong Kong residents shall have the freedom to engage in, shall have freedom of choice of occupation. We like to live in village houses. We can engage in gardening, keep pets. Our elderly don't like to use escalators or lifts. They like to live on the ground floor. even though you can give us PRH, well, if it is not out of our free will, then we cannot really keep our present lifestyle. To be people-oriented, you should give us a village for relocation and give us houses for relocation. Since the World War II, we have successful cases of settling towns, and if the government insists on this way, we have no choice but to lodge a judicial review. I don't know about other villages, but for the Hongshaikyo NDA, there is no reason why we should not seek a judicial review. Mr. Ken, well, many residents are being harassed by developers that have bought land nearby, and farmers would like to have a freezing survey as soon as possible so that they can confirm how much compensation they can get for their plants. I think the response from the administration is very strange. They talk about a non-means tested approach, but they do disregard land and plants. This is strange. They have come to consult us a number of times. I think the government is trying to polarize us. The secretary talked about being humane in treating with us, and then that Madam Chiu quoted various legal provisions saying that squatterers didn't have any title here, and our land could be resumed. I think you are doing this to bargain with us. You force us to accept your arrangements. When you force a community to accept your terms, there can, of course, not be a peaceful conclusion. We have lived here for a long time. We are happy. You force us to move to high rises. It's all right. We do understand. We live in a flat of a few thousand square feet in size. You force us to live in an 800 or 600 foot flat. It's okay, but can you lower the rent? We are trying to seek a solution, but someone from the Development Bureau are so ungrounded. All right, a clearance plan can last for more than a decade. Now, can you say I settled here before 1982, and we should be given priority in the choose of rehousing units. I think the Development Bureau has no intention to resolve the problem. In fact, we have been opposing this for a long time. You refer to laws in Hong Kong saying that we do not have any title. Well, even where we are, Queensway, it was ceded to the British long time ago. How come we're here? Why we have another 33 facilitating measures under SEPA when there was none in the past? Mr. Lai Chang, thank you. I'm Lai Chang. I've come to live in Hong Kong for more than three decades. When I came, I had no knowledge. Some chose to keep pigs and pigeons and some poultry, and I chose to be a vegetable farmer. Now, you have done a freezing survey for the villages, but what about my wells and my farm and these and that? I want you to freeze it as well so that developers will not come and bulldoze my farmland away, and I will not be given any compensation. So I want you to conduct a freezing survey on my farm so that I can have proof. For farmers, it's so difficult for us to make a living. I raised six children. After I came to Hong Kong, I've never asked the government for any money, and I rely on my farm land to survive. So, developers can bulldoze our farms in 3 days, even though there are public holidays in between. I've lived in my house for 30 years, and the government has pushed me away, and I do not get a cent of compensation. So I want the government to conduct a freezing survey as soon as possible so that I can be given compensation. Thank you. Mr. Ken Kakong, thank you. I live in Hong Shui Kiu, a village there. The officials are still using the mentality of the colonial days to talk about things. In 2018, the government started development of Tin Shui Wai in the 1980s, and indigenous villages were moved to our village, and then there were 10 non-indigenous households who've come to settle here. And now we are called Sa Chau Lei Second Village. I'd like to know, was there any gazette or any law passed on that? We started living here in 1957. I've lived here for a long time. I represent villagers who settled here before 1982 because the government started to take action against squatted villages in 1982. So in 1982, we decided to build our own village. You just gave us land and we built our own village. We followed a case back then and we built our own village there. For people who want a rehousing. Now, from 1983 to 2010, you are being you are very kind and generous to this group of people. So you allowed them HOS or PRH rehousing. What about those who who settled here before 1982? How about a 10% discount for every 10 years, counting back from 1982 for purchase of HOS? Why have you allowed squatters to live there for so many years? What have you been doing other than receiving your salary every month? We want more discount for HOS purchase. Now, we're not using that for profiteering. If we want to sell our HOS flats, we have to pay a premium too. We have more discount because we've lived there longer than others. I've lived there for 60 years. Thank you. Mr. To Kwai Ken, Mr. To, it's your turn. I first off wish you good health. I am a villager who faces clearance. I have a lot of grievance and I don't know where to start. I spent decades to build my family. Now I'm going to be driven away. I don't know where to live. Everything will be lost. This is like a jungle, and the jungle rule applies. And I have nothing. I can only ask the government to treat us like the Chuk Yun village. Give us another small village, and give us 1,000 square feet to build a house that can be one or two or three stories, so that I can continue my rural life happily and peacefully. The government was allowed housing houses to be built when reclamation takes place, like the Ablay Chow. So I hope that this approach can be adopted and we will then not be hurt. Thank you. I'll give the floor to officials and then I will allow members to ask questions. Mr. Eddie Ju, Mr. Andrew Wen, and Dr. Kokaki. All right, Mr. Lau Kok Fan. Second round. We will first deal with the first round. Under Secretary for Development. Thank you. I responded in the first session. I have more or less a framework for my response, but the deputations were not here in the first session, so let me repeat. Would it be Wang Chau or Kutong North or Northwest NT? The plan started with the town planning board. I think some of you were aware of the town planning procedures. Not everyone will agree to the decision of the town planning board, but under the current mechanism, the town planning board will make a recommendation to the government after taking into account views of different stakeholders. If you consider the town planning procedures, I think, relatively speaking, the town planning board allows a higher degree of public participation. For instance, different stakeholders can apply to make representations at the town planning board and meet members face to face. And then after recommendations been made by the government or to the government by the town planning board, we have other steps to follow. I know what I'm going to say may not be pleasant to you, but I have to say this. No clearance and no demolition is not a pragmatic approach from the government's perspective. It is not a realistic way of dealing with the problems we have. And as for the squatterers, I think it is better for me to explain the background to you. Now, we first about talked about the licensed licensed squatters. They are allowed to be tolerated for a time being, pending further development. When there is a development planned by the government, then such houses will have to be moved. There are different projects, and as they proceed, different members of the administration would approach the affected residents. I myself have met with residents twice. Some may find our current arrangement undesirable. They want some improvements. I'm sorry. Speakers of mic. All right, Secretary, please continue. Thank you, Chairman. First, on means test. Now, for those squatters, even if they've exceeded the income and asset limits, such as elderly persons, that doesn't mean that they are very well off. They still have needs. Can we waive the limits? Now, under our proposal, if they would want PRH allocation, there are criteria to be satisfied. They have to have lived there for a certain period of time, and they can have the means test waived, and they can be allocated PRH. And for the ex-gratia allowance mechanism, it hasn't been changed for a long time. So now, this is what I didn't mention in the first session. We like to enhance the EGAs. The government has never said that if instead of rehousing, a villager would like to have cash EGA, he can for sure be given $1.2 million. I think we have relaxed certain criteria. First, the requirement for duration of residence at the place, and second, we've also relaxed the requirement on district areas. Now, what if a villager has lived in a smaller size? Perhaps it was because under the old arrangement announced under the Kutong North and Hongshekyu NDA, they may be eligible for a higher level of EGA now, then they will be given the more generous amount. We have been to district councils and also resident meetings. Mr. Lau Kofan asked this question in the first session. If some villagers would like to move out earlier, because for the CNA arrangements, we have to cope with, we have to to complement the development timetable, and some villagers may want to move out earlier, and we are happy to make flexible arrangements for them. But please have no misunderstanding. We do not have a one-off resumption exercise. Some households may choose to live on. Will we force them to go even before the place is not yet due for clearance? The answer is no, but for those who would like to wish early, to leave early, we will move them away and give them a CNA arrangements in an orderly manner. Order, please, otherwise the secretary cannot continue to respond. Please be seated. Ms. Chau, please be seated. Ms. Chau, please be seated. Mr. Ng and Mr. Chau, please be seated. Please, be seated, and we will continue our meeting. Ms. Chau, please sit down, otherwise we cannot proceed. Please keep quiet, otherwise I'll have to suspend the meeting because we cannot go on.
Please go back to your seat and keep quiet. Ms. Chau, please leave the chamber. The meeting is now suspended.